see everybody here this morning. A beautiful Lord's Day. It may be raining outside, but that gives us all the more excuse to come together, doesn't it? And spend some time in God's Word and study in His Word and loving what He has preserved for us. So let's go to Him in prayer before we begin our class this morning. It's good to see John with us this morning. Good to have you back. All right. Let's bow in prayer. Father, we're so very thankful that you love us, that you have given us your word. You've preserved it through the centuries that we might open it now and study and understand some things, the application, even in this Old Testament study as we study the life of David, that there are so many things there that we can learn and glean from this, that we can apply it and use in our life to be more like your son Jesus, to walk as he did. And Father, we ask that you would truly help us to understand these things, that we can live them out and also draw others to you and your gospel message. It's through your son we pray. Amen. Okay, so we are talking about the life of David. And if you did get an opportunity to get a paper out there, you can see where it is that we are going with this. This is not necessarily a straight expository study like we have typically done, where we maybe go through a book of the Bible or something and we go, you know, line by line and pull information out of it. Instead, it's more of a big picture kind of study. It's still expository in nature because we are coming from the text and understanding some things, but we're catching David's life from beginning to end here, from his anointing of Saul all the way through that terrible census that he should never have taken at the end of his life as he is beginning to rely on himself a little bit more than just in God. And so we're going through this and we're seeing that David is very human, that we can see in David, even though he is a forerunner of Jesus, Jesus will be a descendant of David through the line of David, that this is setting a stage for us, especially as we on Sunday nights have been going through the book of Psalms quite a bit, and 73 of those 150 Psalms are from David, attributed to him. And so we're catching an idea of who this David is, that he is very much like us, and yet he is described as a man after God's heart in the book of Acts. That he will do all of God's will. And so there's hope for us, I think. As we look at the story of David, we can see where David messes up, we tend to mess up. And where David does well, we say, well, I could do that if I repented, if I turned back to God, that I don't have to be absolutely 100% perfect without sin, that God gives us plenty of grace and that we can turn back to God when we recognize what it is that we have done. And so today in our story here, when we last left our hero, as they used to say in the old movies, we saw that David was on the run. It became very evident that Saul was out to get him. And David had run, and he first ran to the priests, where the Ark of the Covenant was, and we see that he and his men, there weren't very many at that point, were very hungry, and they had the bread, the show bread that was set out with the Ark of the Covenant, and they ate that, and they were sinless or blameless, as Jesus will later tell us in a story. When the Pharisees are coming against him about eating on the Sabbath little grains in the field. And he says, well, haven't you ever read? And he gives that story about David doing the same thing. We see that Saul finally gets word that, David went to see the priests. Even the priests are against me. And he goes and he kills 85 of those priests. And there's one that escapes. And we're going to see him coming into the story here a little bit more. But at the very end of chapter 22, we see that David is hiding out from Saul, and a lot of people who have been disaffected by Saul's policies, how Saul has turned to himself rather than God, are beginning to accumulate around David, And David, it depends on what kind of leader he is going to be, if he is going to be the kind of leader that will follow God and get those who are following him to follow God, or if he's going to be in the vein of a lot of ancient rulers, including Saul himself, who are relying on himself and the earthly power that he can accumulate for himself. That's what we're going to see in today's lesson here. So there's a number of about 400 that are gathering around David at this particular point. And in comparison to all the other worldly, earthly powers that are out there, that probably doesn't seem like a whole lot. And if we are doing good Bible study, we might say to ourselves, make the application and say, wow, we have a small group here. What can we really do against all the earthly, worldly powers around us that seem so strong? How can we affect this world for good and for God's name? And I think maybe there's an application in there for us in that we need to do right no matter what and trust in God and allow him to take care of the details. So this picture up here, this is they did a dig up at Tel Dan, which is way up in the north of Israel, and they found what they call a stele or stela. And these are pieces of rock or whatever that they might have inscribed on, and on there it has a reference to the house of David. And so David, up until 1993, was thought to be a sort of a mythological figure that was just sort of made up, but we see that indeed he was real, and that the other nations around also knew about the house of David as well and wrote about him. And so we're going to be talking about David escapes Saul, shows mercy to him when Saul is in his hand. Now that kind of gives away the whole study, doesn't it? Talk about spoiler alerts. We should probably, but isn't that the way we usually do things? Bible study for us is, we've read these stories before. Since I was a little kid and maybe Bible class or whatever, I've heard these stories. I know how they go. Why do I need to continue to study the same stories over and over and over again? We don't like to give away the details, do we? 1976. I was 5 years old, and in the newspaper there was a serial that came out daily leading up to Christmas, I guess, in which Billy was fighting this giant, and I was so into it and so loved it that my parents kept those clippings. And then later on, when my dad was taking a course on basic bookbinding, he took those and put them into a book. And here it is, Santa and the Giant Fighter, for me. Well, he says it's for the grandkids, but I think it was for me he did this. Anyway, I still loved it. But as I got reading it to my kids, the last chapter, the heading of the last chapter says this: Billy gets home safe after killing the giant. What a terrible title for a last chapter. It gives away everything that's going to happen. Why even read the rest, right? And sometimes I think that is how we view Bible study sometimes. We can disengage our brains because, oh, okay, yeah, this is the story of where, Saul goes into the cave to relieve himself and David cuts off a corner of his robe and we know this story, but what we miss and what we ought to be thinking about is, why did God preserve these stories for us? Why is it that we just don't have the New Testament? After all, that's a fulfillment of everything that God had been doing. We've got the story of Jesus right there in the New Testament. We've got the gospel right there in the New Testament. Why study things like David? Why go back to Genesis like we did and study the book of Genesis for all that time? Why go through the book of Psalms on Sunday evening? There's things there that we can glean that are still applicable that help us understand things about who God is, the nature that he has, also helps us to understand ourselves and how it is that we have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, how we've separated ourselves because of sin, and God is laying the foundation for His Son to come and to be among us, dwell among us, and die on that cross for us, and then be raised from the dead. There's a lot that we can understand here. And so if we think in Bible class about in terms of what application is there for us, what can we glean from this study, as we're looking at David, who is described as a man after God's heart, what can I learn for my own Christian walk about how it is I ought to live before God and conduct myself? Or maybe there's a lesson not to do. There's often those kinds of lessons as well as we study stories in the Old Testament of what we shouldn't do. Here's the last verse. Oh, excuse me. Yeah.
When did we divide Bible study time from worship time? It seems to me like any Christian would want to be here studying the Bible. Yeah. There's a lot more that comes for the worship hour.
Sure.
Where did that separation take place, or when did we add maybe the Bible study?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think Bible study probably, I don't know this for sure, but I think if you go back into our pioneer days, and we can understand that people would travel and they'd make a day of it, and so they would also have time to be able to study a little bit more and understand a little bit more about God. And now we could choose to drive in at whatever time. It takes us, 10, 15 minutes at the most to get here. So I don't know what... Yeah, that'd be a good thing to research and figure out when Bible study or Bible class first came in. Okay, here's the last verse of the last chapter that we read. And again, taking this idea of application, what can we learn in just the application of this last verse here? Stay with me, do not be afraid. For he who seeks my life seeks your life. With me you shall be in safe keeping. David is saying this to those disaffected folks in Israel who are upset about the way Saul is conducting things, just like all the other nations around. He's being that kind of a ruler, that kind of a king, and they're seeking somebody who will protect them. And so they run to the one who Saul is after, David. But they're being sought as well because they are trying to live life in a different way. They're trying to live before God, and it's not going well for them. I think there's an application here for the church, isn't there? That we who have escaped the world to live for a different world, a world that is to come, this world is not our home, that we are all gathered here, just like they're all gathered with David in the caves, and we're trying to escape Saul, we're trying to escape the world and what's going on around us. We don't want to be any part of that. What do? Do we just huddle in fear in our cave and hope that the world doesn't ever find us? Or does God have a mission for us? And in the three different vignettes that we're going to be seeing in today's study, the one in chapter 23 here, the first one, is going to be just that. That God is saying, I've got a job for you. Your job is not just to huddle in fear from the world, but I've got something for you to get out of your cave and go do in my name. So, we need to discuss whether you're a teabag or a sponge. David was a teabag, all right? Wherever he went, he was diffusing out into the world around him. He was affecting the world around him. We saw that when he first came into camp, when the Philistines in the Valley of Elah, and you've got the Philistines on one hill and the Israelites on the other hill, and David comes in and he hears that for 40 days this giant has been defying God, and David's like, what will be done for the person who slays a giant? who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should be defying the living God? He's a teabag. He's diffusing out into the world. He's showing even King Saul that I can't go with these. I'm not used to these. Instead, I come in the name of the Lord God of Israel, whom you have defied, he tells the giant. He's a teabag affecting the world. And so Saul has become a sponge. He's become like all the other nations around him. He's been soaking up the world and living by worldly principles. And he's just living that out in his life. And yet he's trying to be a leader over God's people, even though God has left him, because Saul has made his choices. And so Saul expects David to act like a sponge as well. If God is with David and David seems to be having success in whatever he does, it must be that David's going to come for me, Saul says. And that evil spirit that comes upon Saul seems to be telling Saul that you got to be wary of David. You got to take him out before he takes you out. Because David is no different than anybody else in the world. He is going to try to come and get you just like anybody else would try to come and get you. See, Saul has worldly expectations of David, who is a man after God's heart. Doesn't the world have worldly expectations about us and how it is that we act, the choices that we will make? They expect us to act in certain ways and talk in certain ways and value things like they value. Are we showing them any different? Is the question, isn't it? How are we living our life? Are we living our life like David, as a tea bag that diffuses out into the world? Or are we living our life like the world lives and soaking up the world to try to be stronger than the world by fighting war in its own way like the world does? So here's the very first few verses here. Now they told David, behold, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are robbing the threshing floors. Therefore David inquired of the Lord, shall I go and attack these Philistines? First of all, God's anointed inquires of the Lord. That's a difference between David and Saul, between the teabag and the sponge. David is going to inquire of the Lord, where Saul has stopped doing that, if he ever did that. And the Lord said to David, go and attack the Philistines and save Keilah. All right, God's got a job. Just don't huddle and hide in this cave with these 400 men that have come to you. I've got a job for you. But these 400 men are scratching their heads and saying, there's so few of us. What are we going to do? How are we going to affect this evil world around us? The Philistines, they have a vast army. There's no way that we could take them. But David's men said to him, behold, we are afraid here in Judah. How much more then if we go to Keilah against the armies of the Philistines? You see, as a leader of God's people, David needs to calm his followers' fears. He needs to let them know that if they trust in God and follow him, that God will be with them. And I think that if you are a leader here whatsoever, when that you could be a leader in your own family, you could be a leader among women, you could be a leader among kids, you could be a leader in so many different ways in whatever ministry that you are working with, or just a leader over the church, that we need to be about faith and calming the fears of those who are following us, to encourage each and every one of us to get out of our cave and go and do God's will. And so here's what we're talking about here. So Keilah is right there. You can kind of see everything's within close proximity to everything. If you look over to the Maon here, the wilderness of Judah, you're going to see a lot of the action coming up right over in this area very soon over here. Philistines have come from the coastal area, and they've come into Israel. They've attacked the Israelite city of Keilah. Then David inquired of the Lord again, and the Lord answered him, arise, go down to Keilah, for I will give the Philistines into your hand. So David saved the inhabitants of Keilah. Even though they were small, even though there weren't many of them, they trusted God, and David's men trusted David, who trusted God. They went and did this mighty work for God because God was with them. Now it was told Saul that David had come to Keilah, and Saul said, God has given him into my hand, for he has shut himself in by entering a town that has gates and bars. And Saul summoned all the people to war to go down to Keilah to besiege David and his men. Wait. Saul is still king over Israel. How come Saul isn't the one that is attacking Keilah? How come he's not the one that is going and rescuing his own people from the hand of the Philistines? Why has it got to be David? Because David is following God. We need to keep this in mind that we have a responsibility to follow God no matter what the situation may be. And we can understand that when you leave God and you become that sponge, you act more like the world acts, you're going to act in worldly ways. Saul's more upset that he wants to get David. He doesn't want to get the Philistines. He wants to get David, one of his own countrymen, rather than these outside enemies that have come in and attacked his own people. The world seems strong against God's people. Then David said, will the men of Keilah surrender me and my men into the hand of Saul? And the Lord said, they will surrender you. Again, David inquires of God, and God says, oh yeah, when faced with Saul and his army coming up to the gates, they're going to say, oh, here's David. we'll let him out to you so they don't get destroyed. That even though the people that David had saved from the Philistines, even though they must have been thankful that David had come in and saved them, fear of Saul, fear of the world, would make them turn against David, their Savior. What's this say as we begin to apply this? And we say we work with people, we study with people, we try to help people, we encourage people, whatever it is. And then those same people will turn around and what? Badmouth you, badmouth the church, badmouth whatever it is, even though you were the one that helped them. You did something good for them. That's the way of the world, isn't it? God's people must keep in step with the Spirit. We need to keep inquiring of God. We need to stay diligent in study and prayer and service to Him to keep in step with the Spirit. And Jonathan, Saul's son, rose and went to David at Horesh. Well, wait a minute. Saul can't find David, but Jonathan can find David. That's interesting. And strengthened his hand in God, and he said to him, do not fear, for the hand of Saul, my father, shall not find you. You shall be king over Israel, and I shall be next to you. Saul, my father, also knows this. Again, this shows the difference in spirit in Jonathan than anyone else, because Jonathan should be the crown prince. After Saul, Jonathan should take the throne according to the worldly ways of ascension to those worldly thrones. But instead, Jonathan, whose soul is knit to David, as we've seen in our previous studies here, he knows that David's going to be the next king. Maybe they even discussed it. Maybe David said, yeah, Samuel came to my house and anointed me with oil, and I'm supposed to be the next king. I don't know. But Jonathan seems to know this, and Jonathan's okay with this. This is a lot like John the Baptist, isn't it? Where John was baptizing people and all sorts of things, and finally some of different ones asked John, what about this? And he's like, I'm not the bridegroom. I'm just the friend who attends the bridegroom. And the friend who attends the bridegroom rejoices when the bridegroom comes. Jonathan's in a very similar situation here where he could take the glory for himself. He could take worldly power for himself. He has a right to that, we might say. But instead, he steps down and allows David to take the forefront. Saul, my father, also knows this, but notice that the information to Saul means something very different than it means to Jonathan. Saul sees it as a threat, and that's why Saul is so adamant about trying to get David out of there. Mark chapter 9, Jesus said, do not stop him, for no one who does a mighty work in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me, for the one who is not against us is for us. I think we've got a lot of allies in the world that may not be us, but they're for us. and they are helping us. One of those allies is the U.S. Constitution that allows us to worship freely. That's an ally. It's not against us. It's for us. And so there's a lot of things out there that allow us to continue to live as God's people and serve as God's people out in the world. How should we interact with help of the world? We should use it as much as we can, just as David would use Jonathan as much as he could. And Saul and his men went to seek him, and David was told. So he went down to the rock and lived in the wilderness of Maon. Saul went on one side of the mountain, and David and his men on the other side of the mountain. And David was hurrying to get away from Saul as Saul and his men were closing in on David. And his men to capture them, it looks really bleak here. You can imagine the 400 men with David saying, uh-oh, this is it. I know we shouldn't have trusted God. Maybe we shouldn't have followed David. A messenger came to Saul saying, hurry and come, for the Philistines have made a raid against the land. So Saul returned from pursuing after David and went against the Philistines. God works in those mysterious ways, doesn't he? To cause a Philistine raid at that particular moment, and word coming to Saul at that particular moment, that Saul would call off the attack. And it's something that David couldn't have caused. And how many times are we unable to cause something that could be our salvation, and God is the one who is with us and intervenes and helps us in that time of need? 2 Corinthians 10 says, for though we walk in the flesh, we are not waging war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to demolish strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ, being ready to punish every disobedience when your obedience is complete. Again, David's not fighting with the warfare of the world. He's trusting in God, and God is helping to fight for David by getting Saul to move off the attack. Very interesting. There might be application there for us, isn't there? How's war different when God's with you? How's God fight for David when Saul is pursuing him? Gets him to call off the attack. Not the way that we would think to fight, but God is in control, isn't he? So confront the world with love is what happens here. Second vignette. And Saul went in to relieve himself. This is chapter 24. Now David and his men were sitting in the innermost parts of the cave, and the men of David said to him, here is the day of which the Lord said to you, behold, I will give your enemy into your hand, and you shall do to him as it shall seem good to you. Then David arose and stealthily cut off a corner of Saul's robe. It seems like, at least for a little while here, David's entertaining what his men are whispering to him, that here's your opportunity against your enemy who is seeking your life. Why don't you go and act like the world would act and take this guy out while he's relieving himself in the cave? Will we act like his people or sons of the world is a question that we have. How are we waging warfare out in the world right now, the spiritual warfare that we're going through? How are David's men acting just like Saul? That's what Saul would do, isn't it? If he had the opportunity to take David out, he would have done it. In fact, he's thrown several spears, as we've read, to try to pin David to the wall. And that's what Saul would have chosen to do, and David's men seem to be following that suit. What will David's reaction be when he listened? He's cut off the corner of Saul's robe, and we see the man after God's own heart is heart-stricken here at this particular point. And afterward, David's heart struck him because he had cut off a corner of Saul's robe. He said to his men, the Lord forbid that I should do this thing to my Lord, the Lord's anointed, to put out my hand against him, seeing he is the Lord's anointed. So David persuaded his men with these words and did not permit them to attack Saul. And Saul rose up and left the cave. See, there's something that we need to realize, that we're all made in the image of God, that we don't war against flesh and blood, Ephesians tells us, but the powers of this world. And so when we're out there, we're opposed by people, we're opposed by very misguided people, people who are not acting right, but they're not the real enemies. And I think David realizes this about Saul, that Saul was the Lord's anointed. He had been anointed by Samuel as well as king. How dare he lift his hand against the Lord's anointed? He doesn't want to act like the world. He wants to act differently than the world. He's got a heart that's after God's heart. He raised up David to be their king. I have found in David, the son of Jesse, a man after my heart who will do all my will. David's heart struck him, it says there. Behold, this day your eyes have seen how the Lord... So David goes out and he eventually comes up to Saul, and or at least from the hilltop, and he's holding up the corner of Saul's robe. And he says, look at this. Look what I've got here. I could have, but I didn't. Why are you out here pursuing me when I had the opportunity just now to kill you and I didn't take it? I didn't act like the world. I didn't act like a sponge. I'm acting like a tea bag instead. This is very different than some other enemy of yours, King Saul. Behold, this day your eyes have seen how the Lord gave you today into my hand in the cave, and some told me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, I will not put out my hand against my Lord, for he is the Lord's anointed. See, my father, see the corner of your robe in my hand, for by the fact that I cut off the corner of your robe and did not kill you, you may know and see that there is no wrong or treason in my hands. I have not sinned against you, though you hunt my life to take it. We are to heap coals, aren't we? And by heaping coals, what are we hoping to do? To get them to see what it is that they are doing and out in the world. To see what those who are opposed against us are doing by their bad behavior towards us. And that they might choose to repent and turn back to God. You see, the result of the spiritual warfare, we don't wage war as the world does, we just read. We're not looking to destroy our enemies. We're looking to try to get our enemies to change and repent. When my kids were teenagers and they were, you know, starting to get into video games and everything else, I says, you know, they ought to create a Christian video game where, you know, you come up to a certain situation and you have a choice of what passage of scripture you might want to use, or some kind act that you could perform for them or something, and it might change their heart and they might repent of their sin and become a Christian. And my son says, that's stupid. I guess apparently it didn't really strike a chord with them, but I thought that would be a much better video game than what you normally see in video games where they're all waging war the way the world does. Oh, well. So how does David kill with kindness here? And how is it that we go out in the world and kill with kindness? We show love out in the world instead of fighting in the way that the world does. We don't shout back. We don't do something back. But instead we turn the other cheek. And we act completely differently than how the world would handle the situation. How are you out in the road? Do you get road rage? Somebody cuts you off? I tend to get a little bit when people are coming at me and they're driving over the yellow line, especially out on Old St. Mary's Pike. I hate that. It's a curvy, terrible road with blind spots everywhere. And here comes somebody down the middle of the road. And like, oh, somebody else is traveling here. And they turn, right, last second, and they don't hit you. But it's a horrible place to be, and you hate to be treated that way. And sometimes I get really frustrated. Angie's probably heard me a few times, probably even on the way in today. So Matthew chapter 5, what does Jesus tell us? But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes the sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. We got some work to do, don't we? David's a man after God's own heart. How can we be men and women after God's heart? How can we wage war in the way that David waged war? How can we kill with kindness? How, when our enemies are put into our hands, can we show mercy and trust God to take care of the situation rather than ourselves? So now we're going to jump to chapter 26. What about chapter 25? Well, that's what I think Jim is handling next week. That's the story of Abigail. And there's a lot of good stuff in there. But it's wedged right in between these two stories of where David has opportunity to show harm to Saul because Saul has been pursuing him and he chooses not to. And I think the theme of chapter 26 is leave room for God's wrath. That's what we're told in Romans chapter 12, isn't it? Verse 19, beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Very similar situation here in chapter 26. David again has an opportunity to kill Saul, but this time he is trying to teach one of his followers, Abishai, his cousin actually, because it's one of the sons of Zeruiah who would be, it wouldn't be a cousin, would it be a nephew? I guess, because Zeruiah would be one of David's sisters, I guess. So this would be his nephews, not cousins. 1 Samuel 26. So David and Abishai, one of his commanders, but also his nephew, went to the army by night. Everybody's asleep in Saul's camp. And they're able to sneak down into the camp, and apparently even the sentries are asleep. All fall asleep because this is something that's not natural. This is different. Everybody's asleep. Nobody notices them creeping into the camp. And there lay Saul sleeping within the encampment with a spear stuck in the ground at his head, and Abner and the army lay around him. Then said Abishai to David, God has given your enemy into your hand this day. Now please let me pin him to the earth with one stroke of the spear, and I will not strike him twice. But David said to Abishai, do not him, for who can put out his hand against the Lord's anointed and be guiltless? Similar situation as the cave in chapter 24. Very similar in that David's man, in this case one man, is saying, look, this is the day that God has given you. How many times have we been told something by even another Christian who is meaning well and saying, oh, I think this is the day that God has given you to act in a very worldly way, because why would God have given you this situation if you weren't to act in this particular way? But we have to rely on the Word of God, don't we? We have to remember that it's God's job to avenge, not ours. That God is the one who will bring the world low. Our job is to remain faithful to God. And so this is what Abishai is saying to David. And very similarly, how is David going to act? Is he going to go and cut off the corner of Saul's robe, very similar to what he did before, and have his heart be struck? Or is he going to use this as a teaching opportunity? How often when we are faced by that in a very similar situation by even a Christian brother or sister, are we able to turn around and make that a teaching opportunity to say, well, God's word says this. And aren't Christians supposed to act like this instead? How can we help others hold the line of what we're supposed to be doing? And David said, as the Lord lives, the Lord will strike him, or his day will come to die, or he will go down into battle and perish. The Lord forbid that I should put out my hand against the Lord's anointed. But take now the spear that is at his head and the jar of water and let us go. Why does he have Abishai take those items? Because he's also trying to teach Saul as well. David is interested in teaching his enemy who is after him, pursuing him for I don't know how many times. And where Saul, it seems like, is going to keep doing that until Saul does go down to his death at some point. And David is going to be this fugitive always for the rest of his life, But he's trying to teach Saul that, hey, we've got to follow God. We've got to do things God's way, not the way of the world. Can we be interested in teaching our enemies as well that there's a better way, that God has given us a better way to handle situations and problems? 1 John 4, we love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. How often do we feel justified in hating those who hate us? After all, they're acting in this terrible, horrible way. I don't like them. I hate them. I don't want to be about them. It should challenge us to not hate them, but to love them and want to see them change, want to see them repent and turn back to God, because they're lost and they need to find their way back. Romans 12, if possible, so far as it depends on you, and you can see this stretched with David and Saul, can't you? Live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink, for by doing so you will heap burning coals on his head. You're hoping to get them to change. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. You see, if David had given in right here, if David had said, okay, Abishai, go ahead, strike him to the ground, one strike, that'll be it, he would have been overcome by evil. When we give in and we allow our enemies to be hated, when we say things, when we do things, we're being overcome by evil rather than overcoming evil with good. Something we got to think about. Then Saul said, I have sinned. This is after David stands on that hill and he's holding up the jug of water, and he's holding up the spear, and he's saying, have one of the young men come and bring these things down to you so you could examine them and see that I had opportunity to do you great harm, but I refused to do it. Saul said, I have sinned. Return my son David, for I will no more do you harm, because my life was precious in your eyes this day. Behold, I have acted foolishly and have made a great mistake. And David answered and said, here is the spear, O king. Let one of the young men come over and take it. The Lord rewards every man for his righteousness and his faithfulness. For the Lord gave you into my hand today, and I would not put out my hand against the Lord's anointed. Waging warfare, not in the way the world does, not as a sponge would do, but instead as a teabag would. Waging war God's way, to kill with kindness and love and respect for his enemy. Feeding him when he's hungry. Giving him drink when he's thirsty. Visiting him. Showing kindness and love in every way possible that God gives us. So I'll leave you with this question. How do you handle the daily choices God puts before you? Let's pray. Father, we live in a very difficult and dark world that is full of Sauls that are pursuing us with hatred, and that venom is very, very sharp and biting. Sometimes we feel, Lord, like we are being pursued like David, on one side of the mountain with him on the other. But instead of us acting like the world would act, let us choose like David did to face the battles of this life in the way that he did. Help us, Lord, not to reach out our hand when we have opportunity and say bad things or do bad things, to act like the world would act and therefore be overcome with evil. But instead, let us overcome evil with good. Help us, Lord, to recognize that if we trust in you, that our warfare has divine power to demolish strongholds. And it's through your Son, Jesus, that we pray this. Amen.
Oh, the Lord, our strength and song, highest praise.